Thank you for joining JTV News. I'm Peter Gay Coombs. Here are the headlines. Man found dead at Windy Hill, Tortola. Is it time for the government to consider an immigration amnesty? A retired politician thinks so.
An earthquake is in the cards here for here now. But we can avoid that.
Prospect Reef paid up.
If they couldn't pay their debt for 4 years, how are they going to pay it in 4 months?
But there are concerns that the government may have been too lax with the state-owned entity and its tardiness in turning over statutory deductions.
The Social Security Board has pursued and will continue to pursue legal actions against all defaulters.
The big story this week, confusing much?
I stand to be corrected, but I don't know that I've said that Bywater has not been sold. I said that the government has not agreed at this point, up to this point, to the sale.
Has government approved by water sale or not? BVI women being bold for change.
It doesn't come like that. You have to actually get into it and push yourself through.
My mother was a teacher and she always told me to look at those hard courses as a challenge, a speed bump that you must roll over to get to the other side.
Office of Gender Affairs aims to inspire young girls. In hot trends, auditions are up for the second edition of Gen Y Factor.
Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could have the competition where it shows that one district produced the best singer for Gen Y this year?
In Caribbean news, Puerto Rico running critically low on cash, and Trinidad and Tobago public sector workers to get back pay by month end. In our Medical Minute segment, how not to diet if you want to lose those pounds quickly. Dr. Geronimo Jones tells us more in our Mayo Clinic Medical Minute. I'll be back with the news in detail after this short break.
This is us. This is how we work. This is how we play. This is how we live. This is us. This is how we flow.
Welcome back to JTV News. The Royal Virgin Islands Police Force, RVIPF, is investigating a case which is believed to be the territory's second homicide for 2017. In the early morning hours of March 10, the body of a man identified as Alston Penn was discovered in the Windy Hill area of Tortola. The East End resident was found in a pool of blood in the middle of the road, and a gaping wound was observed on his head. The gruesome discovery resulted in the stretch of road to Sage Mountain from Stout's Lookout being closed as the RVIPF carried out investigations. Retired politician and a prominent entrepreneur in the BVI, Omar Hodge, has remained behind the scenes in recent years. However, a microphone was placed in his hand recently, and that silence was broken. Hodge reignited his call for amnesty to regularize a specific group of immigrants who have led productive lives in the BVI. Kathy Richards tells us more.
Veteran politician and long-standing member of the Virgin Islands Party VIP Omar Hodge has renewed his call to the government of the Virgin Islands to institute an amnesty to allow persons who came from other parts of the world and contributed significantly to its development to be regularized.
It is through repeated trials, approbation, cooperation, and a willingness to humble selves that we have brought these Virgin Islands from a bird sanctuary to a proper base of hope and a strong hope for the future. And when I said we, I'm talking about the Virgin Islanders and the people who came here in search of a better life, the mixed Caribbean people. That's why you see I'm always fighting with every government to have this amnesty, to properly regularize the people.
On March 4, 2017, Hodge was honored with Oliver Sills, the late Real A. George, Naomi Turnbull, and Donald Pickering at the Virgin Islands Party 46th anniversary fundraising gala, where he told those present that he is 75% human and 25% spiritual. It's that spiritual side of him that forecast what he described as a major earthquake should the National Democratic Party government not heed his warning.
So I would like for Mr. Smith, Orlando, I use Mr. Smith because that's his title because of his qualification, that he take on this task and let's move forward this now. We've got to do it now. Is that earthquake going to hit us? It's going to do a lot of damage. I am telling you. It needs to be done now, and I'm hoping that Dr. Orlando Smith, the premier, the now premier, will put this into action, because we have a report there where I took the strongest of what I had here in the country down to Prospect for nearly a year to put a report together. It's right there. All you have to do, these people work. They work. They help us to build the British Virgin Islands, the beautiful British Virgin Islands.
Hodge twice served as Minister for Natural Resources and Labour. He served continuously as the representative for the 6th District from his elections in the 1979 general elections until his defeat in the 2011 general elections. For JTV News, Kathy Richards.
Works to begin the process of pulling the Prospect Reef property from the doldrums to a place of profitability are beginning to emerge out of the shadows. Premier and Minister of Finance Dr. D. Orlando Smith recently announced that renovations to the hotel at Prospect Reef are to start before the end of 2017. Here is Kathy Richards.
Government is one step closer to realizing the start of renovations to the Prospect Reef Hotel as they are preparing to sign a development agreement with ICA Group BVI Corporation, who is to invest an unknown sum of monies to develop the government-owned property.
Within the coming months, we expect to sign the development agreement with ICA, with an aim to begin rebuilding the property to a standard that would attract business and leisure clientele. Along with offering exceptional accommodation for the leisure traveler, we expect that the hotel will undergo major renovations and improvements aimed at making it a full-service business hotel with proper conference facilities.
Premier Dr. The Honorable D. Orlando Smith was at the time addressing members of the media on March 8, 2017, as he sought to provide an update as to where government stands with the investment to redevelop Prospect Reef Hotel, which he said he is still excited about. Then the question was asked about the sum of monies ICA BVI is likely to invest in the project.
There is no cost mentioned in the memorandum of understanding. After the memorandum of understanding, we're now working towards a development agreement, which will define the entirety of the project, and then we'll be able to have a price attached to it.
The investors, ICA Group BVI Corporation, is a locally owned company with partners overseas, which was awarded the opportunity to complete the redevelopment of the Prospect Reef Hotel and to sign the Memorandum of Understanding with the BVI government in December of 2016. For JTV News, Kathy Richards.
Now, while Prospect Reef awaits its fulsome handover by the government to its new operators, the status of its outstanding statutory deductions owed to the government took center stage in the House on March 9, 2017. Premier Smith admitted recently that Prospect Reef owed the government income tax, National Health Insurance, NHI, and Social Security Board, SSB contributions deducted from employees' salaries for the years 2013 to 2016. Health Minister Ronnie Skelton says Prospect Reef is now current up to 2015, information which astounded opposition member Julian Fraser, who had tabled questions on the matter.
If they couldn't pay their debt for 4 years, how are they going to pay it in 4 months if this company is going to be transferred in a few weeks, days, or whatever the case might be?
Prospect Reef Resort has an outstanding amount of $31,129.56 for 2016. There are no outstanding amount for 2013, 2014, and 2015. 2013 was $30,975.17. 2014 was $30,156.21. 2015 was $31,027.76.
Mr. Fraser sought to find out if the same leniency extended to Prospect Reef will be done for other companies with statutory deduction arrears.
Madam Speaker, the Social Security Board has no intention of writing off the debt incurred by Prospect Reef Resort. The Social Security Board is working with the relevant agencies to ensure that all monies due are paid. The Social Security Board has pursued and will continue to pursue legal actions against all defaulters in circumstances where payment are not at least 6 months in arrears, and attempts to collect arrears or make suitable payment arrangements have failed.
Women in the BVI are ripping up stereotypes and shattering glass ceilings to highlight how locally women are being bold for change. In conjunction with this year's theme for International Women's Day, the Office of Gender Affairs has launched an inspirational campaign. The month-long activities will showcase three successful local women in outdoor professions. Gender Affairs Coordinator Laurelie Connor says these women have been bold for not taking the expected career paths and are examples of change for the younger generation of women. And here are the women who dared to defy the norm. Engineer Shania Smith, Amaral Newton in the field of construction, and environmental marine biologist Dr. Cassandra Titley O'Neill.
I think I was inspired to be an engineer because I grew up around my father, who is a car mechanic. So I've always been interested in knowing how things work and putting things back together.
In the beginning stages, I didn't even know what a marine biologist was. I wanted to be a lawyer, but I always had a love for the sea. And a friend of mine, her mother worked at a dive company, and she told me that she could give me a discount for something called a resort course. And after the first dive, I told my mother, whatever this is what I want to do.
Growing up, both parents are entrepreneurs, self-employed, industrious persons. My dad, particularly, being in construction, I was exposed from a young age of seeing things being made, his work going towards an actual tangible outcome, a building, a luxurious space, and so forth. So I took interest in that. At that juncture, I was more interested in technology, the way the internet worked, equipment worked, and so forth and so on. In our environment, we encounter lots and lots of challenges. There's male stereotyping, female stereotyping, even just simple cultural ifs and ors or buts. I would say from the male perspective, it was a matter of, should we let her into the boys' club? You know, should she be on site? Should she wear the boots? Should she wear the hat? Should she give instructions? Should we even talk to her? From the female perspective, that would go from the look of, you know, a lady should be wearing long heels, long nails, stockings, sitting in a corner quietly. You know, when I show up with my muddy boots and so forth, they look at me as to, you know, I'm out of place. So those two, I think, are the major factors. And they can have real detrimental impact on a person if you're not able to handle it.
A woman of color in a field that is dominated by Caucasian men. My father, he was one of the first scuba divers around here, and he encouraged me a lot to do what it is I wanted to do to make myself happy.
Coming home now and working in the field as a female in construction and project management, you know, I had to overcome a little bit of, you know, resistance to a woman being the project manager sometimes. But, you know, after a while, persons, you know, understand that we know what we're doing, so we get along.
My mother was a teacher, and she always told me to look at those hard courses as a challenge, a speed bump that you must roll over to get to the other side.
Is the BVI ready to join the list of countries who have added number portability to enable telecommunication services to be more consumer-oriented? Third District Representative Julian Fraser is urging Minister of Communications and Works Mark Vanderpool to introduce number portability to the territory. Number portability is the ability to migrate from one telephone service provider to another with the same number.
We need to mandate that a telephone number belongs, the telephone number belongs to the applicant and not the carrier. Despite the abuse you get from that carrier, you're stuck with them. If we are allowed to keep that number, you can move to another carrier with the same number. And this holds true in other parts of the world, Madam Speaker. This happens elsewhere. Your number is yours, and you're allowed to carry it across carriers. And it gives you that flexibility to move when you no longer feel that you're being served properly.
Persons from all walks of life participated in a recent celebratory event of the Virgin Islands Party VIP. There was much applause, but in one instance, those applause were not meant for honorees. Who and why? Kathy Richards has the answer.
On March 4, 2017, the Virgin Islands Party VIP celebrated its 46th anniversary with a gala where they honored four persons who were pivotal to the advancement of the party over the years. The event was also a fundraiser as the party is seeking to reduce its over $100,000 indebtedness. Among those in attendance was a staunch member of the National Democratic Party and a former legislator, Eileen Parsons. She was singled out for recognition by VIP Chairman Andrew Foy.
Cousin Eileen, I'm so glad she's here. You know. Don't mind the noise, I love her with the love of the Lord, and she knows that.
The relationship between Foy and Parsons turned sour on January 30, 2015, during the opening of Farmers Week 2015. Parsons allegedly used profanity and refused to shake Foy's hands as he attempted to greet her. It was believed that at the time Parsons was angry with Foy when he, on January 24, 2015 at Capoons Bay, said the NDP government is the most corrupt in the modern history of the Virgin Islands and called them morally and politically bankrupt. Nonetheless, was Foy extending an olive branch to Parsons, or was he inviting her to join the Virgin Islands Party when she attended the VIP event recently?
So I'm glad to see Miss P there. In case you don't know, we have very close family. So I'm glad that you were able to make it out to represent. And I want you to know that the doors are always open. And never say never, because in this world, I have just started in the present. By the time I finish speaking, it's in the past. Look into the future. So that's how quick things changes.
Foy believes that the best of the Virgin Islands and the VIP is yet to come. For JTV News, I'm Kathy Richards.
And still to come on JTV News, the big story this week, confusion surrounding the purported sale of Bywater. Plus, hot trends with Sophie B. But first, other news making headlines in the Caribbean.
Here in the Virgin Islands, we are blessed to live and work in paradise. Paradise just doesn't mean our tranquil blue waters and green hills. National Bank of the Virgin Islands defines paradise as any place or condition that fulfills your aspirations. To me, paradise means knowing that I will have a financing partner when I'm ready to open my first business. I feel confident that I can manage whatever life throws my way because I know my bank will be with me every step of the way. That's why I choose National Bank of the Virgin Islands, the official bank of paradise.
My future's looking so bright, 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 bright with the official bank of paradise, dice, 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 paradise.
National Bank of the Virgin Islands, the official bank of paradise.
The The board overseeing cash-strapped Puerto Rico's finances has advised the U.S. territory to take major emergency actions to avert a shutdown as it is running out of money. The Federal Control Board says Puerto Rico could face a cash deficit of about $190 million by July. In a letter to Governor Ricardo Rosello, Board Chairman Jose Carrion wrote, quote, "Without major emergency actions, the Commonwealth soon will be unable to pay essential services, including pensions, education, health care, and public safety in a matter of months," end quote. Ghana's former president, Barrett Jagdeo, and several former senior government officials were arrested this week. The high-profile arrests were in connection with an investigation being conducted by the Special Organized Crime Unit into what has been described as the controversial acquisition of seaside lands for housing at Pradoville 2. Those arrested included former President Barrett Jagdeo, now opposition leader, former head of the Presidential Secretariat, Roger Luncheon, and former Minister of Natural Resources, Robert Prasad. All three who were arrested on March 7, 2017, were questioned and released without bail on the same day. Mr. Jagdeo described the arrests as a grave injustice. Several former members of the previous People's Progressive Party administration, including Mr. Jagdeo, are reported to have properties in Pradoville 2. A forensic audit into the land deal found that the recipients underpaid for the seaside lands by more than 250 million Guyanese dollars, while the subsequent sale of the lots acquired by at least two former ministers went for $100 million and 90 million Guyanese dollars each. And public sector employees in Trinidad and Tobago who have been demanding back pay owed to them will have to wait no more. Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, Dr. Keith Rowley, committed in Parliament on March 6, 2017, to clear the arrears of $2.5 billion, which he said is the result of a 14% wage increase the previous government granted but had no recurrent revenue to finance. Dr. Rowley stated that while half of the back pay has already been delivered to civil servants, the monies to pay the remainder are to be borrowed and paid by the end of March. President of the Public Service Association, Watson Duke, has charged that no excuses will be tolerated if the government falls short in making good on the monies owed. Coming up on JTV News, the big story this week: by water confusion and hot trends with Sophie B.
This is us. This is how we work. This is how we play. This is how we live. This is how we flow. If you're looking for extra savings and free benefits
with car insurance
and home insurance,
Colonial has just the cover you need.
There's a free $250 gift voucher for new home insurance customers too, and 10% car insurance discount if you have home insurance.
With a claim service that's quick and friendly,
we call it Cover Without Added Costs.
Call for a quote on 494-8450 or Virgin Gorda 495-6403 or visit cgigroup.com.
Colonial, where people come first.
Welcome back to JTV News. It's time for our big story. This week, Kathy and I discussed the confusion that remains after questions were asked about buy water in the House of Assembly, which left more questions than answers. The big story this week: buy water confusion. As Communications and Works Minister Mark Vanderpool disclosed in the House of Assembly on Thursday that the government has not sanctioned any sale of by water. No, Kathy, by water, based on information that came out publicly, has come out publicly before, is now known as Seven Seas Water. But the opposition member, Julian Fraser, sought to get some answers on that sale, and in particular, whether the government has had any role to play in that purported sale. And this is what Minister Vanderpool's response was to that query.
I stand to be corrected, but I don't know that I've said that Bywater has not been sold. I said that the government has not agreed at this point, up to this point, to the sale. Any legal questions like that, I am not in a position to answer. But I know that I did not say that Bywater was not sold.
So, Kathy, there you have it. The mystery coming out of Parliament this week, which has left quite a few persons scratching their heads as to, so what exactly is the legal status of Bywater or Seven Seas in relation to Bywater and Bywater in relation to Seven Seas? And has the government played any role in this whatsoever, if the government is saying that it hasn't sanctioned the sale?
Well, the thing is, I can recall back in 2015, it was that the premier, during a press conference, was asked about this very sale arrangement. He did say that they were engaged in discussions with a company, themselves, that company, and Bywater as it relates to selling the company. He declined exactly to name the company at that time. Ever since then, we haven't heard the government declaring that Bywater was sold. But what we did see was a statement from the Bywater parent company saying that they are now the owners of Bywater BVI, and there it laid.
And that company, Seven Seas, which purportedly bought Bywater, is owned by Acro Ventures Holding, which in turn is owned by billionaire Richard Branson. And they disclosed back in about August of 2015 that they were the new owners of Bywater. So the question continues to be, what, if anything, does the government know about this transaction? And has it played any role whatsoever? Because another question that pops up coming out of this discourse in the House recently is, if indeed Bywater has been sold to Seven Seas, then how legally binding is that sale if, as Mr. Fraser has stated, the sale can only take place if the government sanctions it?
Yeah, and Minister Vanderpool is saying the government did not sanction. We didn't hear from the Premier at any point saying that.
The Premier actually wasn't in the House.
Oh, yes.
At this session.
Yeah, but in any forum where this issue came up, there was no way that the government said they sanctioned, apart from what I mentioned before, the Premier saying that they had some discussions as it relates to sale. So we don't know if there is any legal implications as it is. That was under the bed all the time that opposition member Fraser is now trying to pull out for the people to see. That is the big question.
Yes, indeed. And another big question, the tale of the two Bywaters, as was disclosed by Mr. Fraser, which the minister couldn't quite answer because he himself had to admit that one of those companies he isn't aware of. There is Bywater BVI and there is Bywater Holdings. And so Mr. Fraser also sought to get answers on, why were these two companies created? What was their function? And this is the exchange that took place in the House of Assembly regarding that matter.
If the agreement was with Bywater SA, how is it that Bywater BVI is a company that's in discussions, negotiations, or the ones that they're trying to buy the company from? Where did Bywater BVI come in?
Since 2012, I believe, or 2013, we've been dealing with Bywater BVI Limited.
Yes, Madam Speaker, I agree that Bywater BVI Limited, yes, was a company established for the sole purpose of constructing the water plant at Parakeeta Bay. Bywater BVI Holding Limited, however, I submit that that company was established for the sole purpose of transferring the assets to Aqua, or the Seven Seas. And that's a question I want answered, to know when this company was established and why was it established. But the answers doesn't seem to be forthcoming, Madam Speaker.
And I'm not sure which company the member was referring to in the end. Like I said, we signed the agreement with Bywater SA. And along the lines, Bywater BVI Limited came into play. All of the agreements with the banks and the guarantors in the United Kingdom were between Bywater BVI Limited, and therefore this is the company that was dealing with. I don't know what arrangement, and we haven't accepted and finalized what arrangements may have been made, may or may not have been made, with Bywater BVI Limited and the company that is has proposed or has purchased it. So I cannot legally, I cannot give the member an answer, as we, these matters are not completely settled. I wish I could, but I can't.
So Kathy, Bywater BVI, according to Mr. Fraser, created to for the construction of the Parakeeta Bay water plant, and Bywater Holdings supposedly created for the sale of Bywater to Seven Seas. Mm-hmm.
So what really is the point that Mr. Fraser is trying to get at? What is that answer that he's looking forward? Why is it that he is insisting on having a direct response from the government official to say, yes, it is sold, or yes, it is not sold?
And that is the very big question that we're still awaiting those answers, if the government has those answers. Hence why there is this new mystery surrounding this whole Bywater affair.
But the thing that is a little more complicated as well is that the government is using the name Seven Seas to do, because remember in the recent press conference that we had with the signing of the purchase agreement MOU. And the MOU he announced said Seven Seas bracket Bywater. So what's going on?
Another issue that Mr. Fraser also pressed Minister Vanderpool on, which again, there were no answers that the minister said he could provide, is that of the assets owned by Bywater/Seven Seas. Because based on what Mr. Fraser said in the House, if it is that Bywater has indeed been sold to Seven Seas, the government has a role to play in this. Mm-hmm. And if that indeed took place, then the government should know exactly, in addition to the Parakeeta Bay plant, what are the other assets that Bywater had that are now in the hands, supposedly, of this new company, Seven Seas.
We don't know what the contracts say directly. We don't know what certain laws of the British Virgin Islands says towards a company being sold or changing name or so. So until we can get those bits of information and those hard facts, it's just a mystery.
Yes. And while we await that information from the government and whosoever else is out there by water, Seven Seas Water, to furnish the public with this information so that this issue can be a mystery no more, let's turn to another matter which ended up in the news headlines this week, that of BVI Airways' application for U.S. certification being challenged by two regional airlines, both of them operating from right here in the BVI.
Yes, we have Intercaribbean is operating out of Turks and Caicos, but they do transit here, and VIA Airlink. And this comes now at a time when persons are beginning to get comfortable that BVI Airways is now just waiting on this last piece of document from the U.S. aviation arm to start the flying. And here we are now with a supposed petition that is being filed by Intercaribbean and the local BVI Airlink. What they are claiming now is that the U.S. body failed to meet a certain criteria, which they were supposed to provide certain information to these two airlines, because they are likely to be affected with the impetus of this new airline. And so the big question is now, how much longer do we have to wait for the
BVIA to get up and running to add to the much needed airlift that this country needs and that the premier has been touting. Until next week, on behalf of Kathy Richards and Peter Gay Coombs, saying check us out on our YouTube page, Facebook page, and our website, jtvlive.net. Bye-bye. In this week's Hot Trends, Sophie B tells us about the auditions of this year's Generation Y Factor.
JTV Hot Trends, it's your girl, the one and only Sophie B. And ladies and gentlemen, it's that time again, Gen Y Factor. Some young hopeful is looking for the opportunity to be the next winner, and we are here at the audition.
Well, you know, we have 9 districts in the territory, and we thought, wouldn't it be wonderful if we could have the competition where it shows that one district produced the best singer for Gen Y this year. So what we've done is we've gone throughout the territory and we've promoted. We've asked everyone between the ages of 15 to 29 sign up, and on each form it says which district they are in. Yeah. We will pick the top 2 scores from each district, which will then move on to the semifinals. So there's actually a mini district battle, because you got to get in that spot for your district. And then at the semifinals, you'll fight for that one placement to represent your district in the big battle.
Where do I begin? No words can explain the way I'm missing you. You can sharpen your knife. Offer me thy death and death, good God. But I can't help falling in love with you.
We're now here with
Shalon Joseph.
And you're repping which district?
5th district.
The 5th district. All right. So why did you decide to be a part of the Gen Y competition?
Well, I decided to join the Gen Y Factor because I sing a lot while growing up, and people told me that I have a good voice and I should join the Gen Y Factor, so I made the decision to join it.
No one knows how far it goes, and it seems like it's calling out to me, so come find me. And long for heaven and home. No scars to your beautiful where stars and we're beautiful. Oh.
We're now here with the wonderful Tori. Tori, how are you?
I'm fine.
Now, you already had your audition. Tell us how it went for you.
It went good, I guess, but then the nerves kind of took over me. So next time I just have to try not to be nervous and think I'll do better.
Oh, the blood that gives me strength from day to day.
We are looking forward to picking up another youth ambassador for the company, and that person wins a great handset. We keep them connected for the entire year. We now have an LTE package, so we may be able to extend LTE to them as well, and they can look forward to being the face and the voice of digital for the youth population of the Virgin Islands.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you guys enjoyed those auditions. Some lucky boy or girl, they're going to be the next Gen Y Factor. Right about now, we have the man Darnell Sanders doing his thing, and of course, we're going to take you through the whole process from the auditions all the way down to the final competition, and all you got to do is keep it locked right here to JTV Hot Trends Channel 55 as we bring it to you.
Up next in our medical minute, getting rid of the yo-yo diet and trading up to the Mediterranean diet.
Hopefully that will translate into less of the yo-yo dieting, which really may have a negative impact on our heart health.
Dr. Geronimo Jones is next with that report from the Mayo Clinic. Stay with us.
Eureka, located in the British Virgin Islands. Come discover Eureka Medical Clinic, which provides the most complete medical services in the Virgin Islands. Our state-of-the-art clinic offers the highest quality in specialty care, cardiology, gastroenterology, orthopedics, and spinal surgery. We also offer specialty care in obstetrics and gynecology, as well as dermatology. Eureka Medical Clinic offers diagnostic procedures such as x-rays, mammograms, CAT scans, and all forms of ultrasound exams. Now, for the first time in the BVI, Eureka offers MRI scanning too. With colonoscopy and gastroscopy, we check the intestines and stomach for polyps, colon cancer, and ulcers too. Located at Geneva Place in the heart of Road Town, Eureka Medical Clinic with Medicare Pharmacy and Labs offers you a comprehensive medical facility all under one roof. So for high-quality medical services and convenience, there's no need to look any further. Eureka, you found it.
You have a big event coming up and need to fit in that great dress, so you crash diet, only to gain it all back again. If this sounds familiar, you could be yo-yo dieting. But research shows yo-yo dieting, also called weight cycling, is hard on your heart. Dr. Amy Pollock says one way to avoid the problem associated with yo-yo dieting is to eat accordingly to the Mediterranean diet, which incorporates fruits, vegetables, whole grains, fish, olive oil, nuts, low-fat dairy, and using herbs and spices instead of salt to flavor foods. In this Mayo Clinic Minute, reporter Vivian Williams talks to Dr. Pollock about the health risks of yo-yo dieting and how to work in a healthier, stable eating plan.
The ups and downs of yo-yo dieting.
So many of us have done a yo-yo diet.
Mayo Clinic cardiologist Dr. Amy Pollock says research presented at the American Heart Association's annual meeting shows postmenopausal women who yo-yo diet,
where they gain weight and then lose weight and gain weight and then lose weight, seem to be at a higher risk for cardiovascular death. So that means dying from a heart attack or stroke.
Dr. Pollock says it's not clear yet why yo-yo dieting's unhealthy, so more research is needed. But she says they do know one diet that's proven to lower your risk over time, the Mediterranean diet, which features 5 servings of fruits and vegetables a day, whole grains, fish, olive oil, nuts, and low-fat dairy.
Hopefully that will translate into less of the yo-yo dieting, which really may have a negative impact on our heart health.
For the Mayo Clinic News Network, I'm Vivian Williams.
And before we go, a brief look at the main headlines. Police investigating the suspected murder of Alston Penn from East End. Former politician Omar Hodge proposes an immigration amnesty to the government to regularize persons who have contributed to the BVI economy for years in spite of their undocumented status. Health Minister says Prospect Reef paid its statutory deductions owed for the past 4 years to the SSB in January of this year. Other businesses will only have a window of 6 months. Third District Representative Julian Fraser says the BVI is ready for number portability to allow residents to keep their telephone numbers when they migrate from one network to another. Engineer Shana Smith, construction expert Amaral Newton, and environmental marine biologist Dr. Cassandra Titley O'Neill are the 3 successful women featured in the Office of Gender Affairs' month-long campaign to inspire young girls to embark on non-stereotypical careers. The big story this week, Communication and Works Minister Mark Vanderpool's answers to questions posed by opposition member Julian Fraser about Bywater Now Seven Seas leaves more questions than answers, as the minister says he is unaware if Bywater has been sold as the government hasn't sanctioned any sale. In regional news, the Federal Control Board overseeing Puerto Rico's financial affairs has told the U.S. territory to take emergency action as it could run out of money by July. Trinidad and Tobago government employees to be paid $2.5 billion in back pay by the end of this month. And Ghana's former president Barak Jagdeo and several other former government officials released after being detained for questioning in connection with the Prattoville 2 seaside land housing scheme. Now, just a reminder that you can find all the news stories featured in this newscast as well as previous newscasts on our website Additional information and news updates can be found on our Facebook page, facebook.com/JTV55. If you haven't already, please visit our Facebook page to let us know that you like us. Of course, all our news features, press conferences, and JTV's television programs can be found on our JTV News YouTube channel. Subscribe for daily uploads. We welcome your questions, comments, and news stories. Email us at jtvnews@hotmail.com. On behalf of the entire production team, I'm Peter Gay Coombs. Thank you for watching.